راديو كايرو اف ام 95.4 The Voice of Egypt. It's 4 o'clock in Radio Cairo. This is World of Info. We're coming live from Studio 3. My name is Dr. Amr Mabrouk. Dua Muhammad is at the controls. And it's a beautiful afternoon in Cairo. And today, as usual, sometimes we present to you the world of books. And today we are presenting 4 books for you, a challenge to read. You know, every time there is the rules of the game. And the rules of the game, should we read this book? Should we toss it? Or should we skim it? Well, you have to trust me in that. When I read the book, I always think that it deserves to be ended and to be read. And if the book doesn't deserve to be read, I would not ever try to present it to you in this program. So 4 books that I read, 4 books that consumed some time, but they were all enjoyable. So come with me to the world of books. Today we're having 4 books to present. We have the Stories of the Egyptian Mamluks by Dr. Hani Hamza, Days of Al-Mahrusa by Muhammad Mahmoud Hanafi, The Memoirs of an Egyptian Soldier in the Suez Canal Front by Ahmed Haggi, and Napoleon. This is Napoleon by Paul Johnson. So we start right away with the first book, and the book today is The Stories of the Egyptian Mamluks. And yes, this is an interesting book because it comes from the one and only Dr. Hani Hamza, who is a Mamluk dynasty, both dynasties historian. He received a degree from the American University as an undergraduate, and also a master's degree from the American University, and a PhD from the Archaeology Faculty of Archaeology in Cairo University in the history of Mamluk architecture. So if we are going to get a reference to talk about Mamluks, definitely it will be Dr. Hani Hamza, and of hopefully I will try to reach him, and maybe he would come and honor us to be a guest in our program soon. So Dr. Hani Hamza has 2 beautiful books, first part and the second part, that are dedicated to the history of the Mamluk dynasty. We all know that the Mamluks are Bahari Mamluks or Borgi Mamluks, and the Borgi Mamluks. And they started, if we may be very accurate, at the year 1249 with the death of Saleh Nijmuddin Ayyub, the Sultan, the Ayyubid Sultan of Egypt, who was the first to introduce the Mamluk system. And the Mamluk system is a very strange system that is very unique for Egypt and unique for what happened. Because the Mamluks, and a Mamluk means owned by, or actually it means a slave. And so how come a slave can become a king or a general or an officer or a distinguished minister? Well, this is the secret of this system. It all started with Saleh Nijmuddin Ayyub, who decided to buy some young slaves who were looked promising to be physically fit and strong, and especially in their young age. They may be 8 to 12 or 14, so they're still young. And when he purchased them, instead of making them slaves, as a real slave should be humiliated or whatever, no, they were given very superb education on the military side and on the religious side. And they were put in barracks where they received strict military uprising, where they are totally, since they are bought or being kidnapped from their families, so they are simply don't have any families in Egypt. So these children, when they reach adolescence, they know only that they are professional soldiers in the royal guard of the king. And the king was Saleh Nijmuddin, who bought a very big group of these young soldiers who became very loyal to him because they were brought when they were young age. He put them in a special island, that is the Manyal Island. That's why they were called Al-Bahari Mamluk, because their barracks was there and their small citadel where they had their training and had their logistics and lodging over there. These soldiers of fortunes, they were not soldiers of fortune. They were simply loyal soldiers and royal guards for the king himself. And in the year 1249, Egypt has been attacked by Louis Louis-IX, or the King of France, and this King of France invaded Dumyata and reached Mansoura, and it was a very critical situation. Salah Nejm al-Din took his army, which with its elite royal guards, to try to defend Egypt from the northern frontier at the Mansoura and at the Dumyata. Strange enough, what happened was that Salah Nejm al-Din Ayyub caught an illness and died and in the arms of his wife, who was also a Mamluk, and her name was Shagarat al-Durr. Shagarat al-Durr was, as people call her, was Armenian. Some people say that she was an Armenian lady or Armenian slave by nature that was bought by the king, and later on the king gave her her liberty and married her. Shagarat al-Durr was a very intelligent lady who decided that she is going to keep the secret of Salah Nejm al-Din Ayyub's death from the rest of the army so that it doesn't bring the morales down. And she decided that she is going to help the kings, the king royal guard, to try to defend the whole of Egypt from Mansoura. It was a very critical situation. Louis-IX has already reached Mansoura and almost occupied it. But thanks to the brutality, the braveness, and the sharpness, and the shrewd well-bringing or upbringing of these royal guards who formed the elite force of the main Egyptian army, and namely a man by the name of Zahir Babers with Saif al-Din Qutuz and the rest of the army, including Aqtai and Aybek, all these with great bravery were able to defeat, not only to defeat the crusaders, but to force them to give up and surrender. And on top, the top man who surrendered on that day was the king himself, who was kept until a handsome ransom was paid by his mother, by his wife later on. So when we talk about the start of a great victory that happened, Turan Shah, the son of Salah Nejm al-Din from another marriage, came rushing by and wanted to take back his kingdom, while Shagarat al-Durr at that time was a regent or was the queen. Turan Shah started in a very wrong move to attack the Mamluks and ask them to give him full obedience. The Mamluks were very skeptical of Turan Shah and thought that he might arrest them, kill them, or slaughter them. So they decided to kill him first. So Turan Shah was killed, and Shagarat al-Durr was kept on the throne for a short period of time to become the first Mamluk queen or royal. The Shagarat al-Durr received a very terrible letter from the Abbasid Caliphate in 1250 and saying to her, "If you don't have a man to rule Egypt, we can send you one." Shagarat al-Durr at that time, of course, decided that she is going to try to control the throne and to control the kingdom from behind the scene. And she decided to marry one of the weakest prince or the Mamluk prince at that time, and his name was Azzedine Aybak. Azzedine Aybak turned out not to be as naive as she thought and not as weak as she thought. So Aybak by time told her, "You should stay in the harem and you should not come out to give me any advice." Shagarat al-Durr felt very much betrayed, and especially when he asked his first wife to come back to him. Shagarat al-Durr decided to kill Azzedine Aybak, and it started another cascade of events that she herself was killed. At that time, there was an invasion of Egypt, or a threatening of invasion of Egypt by the Mughals. And when the Mughals approached Egypt, Saif al-Din Qutuz, one of the sharpest Mamluks, decided to get on the throne and start to defend the country in Ain al-Galud battle with the famous Zahir Babers. He was able to defeat the Mamluks, and later on Zahir Babers felt that Saif al-Din Qutuz is going to kill him, so he decided to kill Saif al-Din Qutuz before him being killed. So this is actually the real start of the Mamluk dynasty. We can find ourselves with Shagarat al-Durr, later on Azzedine Aybak, excuse me, and of course later on we can find and we can find of course besides Azzedine Aybak we can find also after that Saifuddin Qutuz and then the Zahir Babers. So with the Zahir Babers there starts a new story. Still listening into World of Info with the World of Books, and we're talking about the story of the Egyptian, the stories of Egyptian Mamluks by Dr. Hani Hamza, and we are talking about Zahir Babers. Over him, Egypt has seen the real start of the Mamluk dynasty and the Bahri Mamluks, and Zahir Babers was a great man who ruled Egypt from 1260 till 1277 and was very, really an intelligent and a sharp and a shrewd man with great intelligence and great military skills, and was able to defeat the Crusaders in many different and invade their garrisons along the beach. So when we talk about this gentleman, we'll find ourselves that we're talking about the real Mamluks. When Dr. Hani Hamza has written this book, he tried to make a sort of presentation for the average reader to get some information that might attract his attention to go further and read more about the Mamluks. And my suggestion is, if you start reading this book, you will attract your attention to read more about the Mamluks, and then you can go to the more bigger scope of the Mamluk dynasties written by the same author, Dr. Hani Hamza, about the Mamluks. So in order to attract the attention of the reader, he has chosen some interesting stories. And I believe these interesting stories really definitely affect our taste and understanding of the Mamluks. He went through with many different stories about and different chapters about the Mamluks. We have talked how the Mamluk system has arisen and how these people changed from slaves to masters. We talked about how these Mamluks proved themselves more or less to be related to their master in the beginning, and their master was Saleh Nijmuddin Ayyub. Later on, they felt as colleagues, and nobody deserved to be having a higher rank from the other. And that's why the amount or the time that such a Mamluk would stay on the throne depends on his power and on his wit and on his charm. However, sometimes, like when we see with the Qalawun, who followed Zahir Babers to ruling after the end of the rule of the two sons of Zahir Babers, we can find that Qalawun's children were sometimes put on the throne and dethroned for no reasonable reason but the fact that they are young, and therefore they are just acting as puppets with the strong thrones, with the strong princes that we can see. When we talk about Qalawun, we have to mention two of his great sons. Khalil ibn Qalawun, or Khalil the son of Qalawun, although he ruled Egypt for only a few years, just 3 years, and he was killed, but he, for him to it has the great favor of getting rid of the last crusaders' place, or the last garrison of the crusaders in Acre. And when he was able to kick these crusaders, it was the end of the crusades in the Middle East, and this year was 1291. Another important sultan from the Bahri Mamluk is Sultan Hassan, Sultan Nasir Muhammad. Nasir Muhammad is the younger brother of Khalil ibn Qalawun. He was put on the throne twice and was removed, and in two times, and the third time when he was put back to the throne, he proved to be one of the most intelligent and the most shrewd politicians of his time. He stayed on the throne for a very long period of time until his death, and he proved to be a very great builder of Cairo, and he has changed really the fate and the intelligence of Cairo itself. When we talk about Nasir Muhammad, he had seven brothers, who he had seven sons, and or almost eight, who went to the throne removed or killed mysteriously because of the competition between the princes, putting children or young children of Sultan Nasir Muhammad always ended up with definitely either killing or beheading of these young sultans, inexperienced sultans. So as we go through the 13th century and the 14th century, these are the centuries of the early Mamluks or the Bahari Mamluk. After that, we go to the late Mamluk or the Burji Mamluk, who started in the year 1382 with Barquq, who was a Cherkasi Mamluk or a Burji Mamluk, whose barracks in strain in difference to the barracks that were built in Manya Roda Island, they were living in the citadel itself. That's why they are called Burji Mamluk, and their origins are Cherkess, not as Turkish as the other Mamluks. When we talk about them, we'll find of them, some of them are good and effective, others were just passerbys. And of course, if we are going to mention, we have to give a tribute to Brisbai, and of course to the famous Qaid Bai, who was a great builder. And of course, if we should always mention Muayyad Sheikh, who had different types of history that deserves definitely an episode in and out of itself. When we leave this period, we reach one of the latest sultans, or the sultan before the last, and this is Consoor Ghori, who has tried very much to secure Egypt and failed because of the bankruptcy that happened from the change of the route of commerce to the route of good hope. And where we find that Consoor Ghori died in the battle after the he had a severe stroke after finding that his lieutenants have betrayed him, and he has fallen in a defeat from the Turks or advancing Ottomans led by Selim the First. Tumanbay is the last of the sultans, and he is definitely a great man. The man who tried to defend Egypt, the man who tried to make a revolt against the Ottomans, the man that Selim al-Awwal or Selim the First found in him a great character, strong wit and sharp, and at the same time he felt that this man really could cause him a lot of danger, and therefore he ordered him to be hanged. So in a very short resume, we talked about the Egyptian Mamluks, and a book that deserves to be read. Some stories that will attract your attention to read more about Mamluks, carefully knitted by Dr. Hani Hamza in his book, The Stories of Egyptian Mamluks. So this is the World of Info, and today is the World of Books. And the second book that we're going to present today is The Days of Al-Mahrusa, or The Days of Egypt. And this is by Muhammad Mahmoud Hanafi. And it's a really an interesting book. Why is it interesting? Because it's also giving us some short stories and resumes about Egypt, but not in the medieval period, not in particular about the Mamluks, although it has its own share from stories about the Mamluks, but it also has given us some more information and more small short stories about periods before the Mamluks. He has talked about the Fatimids, he has talked about the Ikhshids, he has talked about the Ibn Tulun and his great mosque. So when we talk about this period in particular, we'll find ourselves getting more into interesting talks about Egypt. He has described in full details the road to the Fatimids, how the Fatimids reached power, and how Mu'izz al-Din Allah, when he came to Egypt, he came here to stay, that he even brought with him the dead bodies of his ancestors to bury them in a special cemetery beside the palace, the newly structured palace in Cairo. The story of Cairo is very important to know, because Cairo in particular is the northern part of a very old capital of Egypt. We know that the Egyptians, or the ancient Egyptians, have chosen to have Memphis to be the capital of the old kingdom. And we can always see the pyramids which are stationary in front or stayed in front of definitely slightly in the, to the north of Memphis itself. Why Memphis? Because it is the apex of the delta. It's the site where the Nile divides into two branches, and in between these two branches is the most fertile delta anywhere in the world, and that is the Nile Delta. So this important strategic point has to be always the capital. For logistic reasons and for defense reasons, the Egyptians have transferred their capital later on to Thebes. Why Thebes in the south? Because it was the capital of Ahmus, the great prince who later on became the king, the one who got rid of the invaders and of the Hyksodes, which are the nomad tribes that ruled Egypt for some time after the Middle Kingdom. And he decided to make Thebes the capital of Egypt, not Memphis, first of all because in order to give gratitude to the capital or the city where he was born, and the second important point, to keep the capital away from the rest of the country to the south, where it is well protected, and therefore should there any be trouble and any invaders like what happened during the Hyksodes time, they will take great time to reach Thebes, and by then the Egyptians would have defeated these invaders. However, when Alexander the Great came, he built Alexandria to be the capital of Egypt. And why Alexandria in the north, on the sea, to be near to his Greek empire, and on the northern sea to reach it very easily. However, Alexandria was the capital of Egypt also, or the state of Egypt during the Roman invasion and Roman rule of Egypt. When Amr ibn al-As came, he found out that there was the famous station of Babylon there, and he decided to keep his structuring over there, and he decided that he's going to build his capital there, and this capital was al-Fustat. In the Fustat, or the camp, was the capital that he decided to make, bringing it into the same strategic point where that is the capital of Egypt, like in the site of Memphis. When Ahmad ibn Tulun, who was an Abbasid governor sent to govern Egypt, decided to have his own independence from the Abbasid Khalif, he decided to build a new capital, calling it the Qata'a, and this was north to Fustat. And he built in it a very beautiful mosque, and this mosque is the Ibn Tulun Mosque. However, after the defeat of the grandchildren of Ahmad ibn Tulun, the Abbasids came back to rule Egypt, and they destroyed all the places or everything in the mosque, in the area of Qata'a, except the mosque that was here to stay up till now. So there the mosque stayed, and there the mosque was a sort of memorizing or memory of Al-Qata'a. When the Fatimids came from the west, they decided to build a capital for them, and this has to be a military capital, that they are keeping out the rest of the citizens, because the Fatimids were Shiite and they wanted to have their own military camp that is protected by a camp and by a garrison of soldiers and walls. And the walls has gates that allow in the people in the morning for trade or for their own business, and then in the evenings they are kicked out of the city, of the isolated city, to become to get out of it, and the city gates are closed in the evening. However, as we always know, that the gates are meant to be open, not to be closed, and by time the gates of Cairo became open, not just for the invaders, but also opened for the rest of the people around it. And that's why the capital of Cairo started to expand, even increasing from or overflowing from the walls of Cairo that we have known. So when we talk about the gates of Cairo, where what's left of them, the gate of victory and the gate of conquest, and also the gate of Zuwaira. For us, before we leave the beautiful book of the days of the Mahrusa, we have to give a mention of the gate of Zuwaira. The Zuwaira gate was renovated and built by Prince Badr Gemali, who was a minister, of the Fatimids during the period, the second period of the Fatimid dynasty, and he was a great administrator. And the gate is the southernmost part of the gate that takes you and lead you to Al-Fustat. However, there was a famous jail next to this gate that has once had one of its prisoners, and by the name of Muayyad Sheikh. And this prince was put in the jail, and he said, if I ever get out of this jail victorious, I will destroy the jail and build a mosque instead. And strange enough, he not only was released from jail, he became the Sultan of Egypt, and he kept his promise, built a beautiful mosque near the gate of Zuwaila, and has taken the two minarets of the mosque to be lying on top of the two pillars of Zuwaila Gate, making it a very characteristic and beautiful appearance of Zuwaila Gate in this site. So when we talk about the Cairo and the beauty of its Cairo, you have to be more stimulated to read and go more to examine for yourself the beauty and the mystique and the mysteries of Cairo. They say that every stone in Cairo, behind it, that there is a story. And I believe not every stone in Cairo just like that, but every stone in Egypt has a story about it and behind it. The Egyptians have been always living in a narrow valley, and therefore the number of people who lived in the same place go back to hundreds and maybe thousands of years, occupying the same area and living in the same place, having every one of them their own story to tell. Well, the third book of today is really an interesting book, and it's a very emotional one, and it's a book that deserves to be read. It's a very short book, like the life of its author. Yes, it's just 150 pages maximum, and it talks about the memoirs of an Egyptian soldier in the Suez Canal front by Ahmed Haggi. Ahmed Haggi is an Egyptian soldier. He was a graduate from the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine. And he was a talented writer and very much into culture and reading. And this young gentleman, after graduation from the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, was conscripted in the army after 1967 war. Reaching the borders of the conscription center, they were writing down their demands, and everybody was trying to stay behind lines, and in Cairo or in Alexandria, and usually the doctors or physicians or even some of the medical background could be asked to stay behind the lines. Ahmed Haggi approached the commander of the camp, asking to be transferred to the furthermost frontier on the front, asking to be a soldier there in order to help in any way to defend the country. He started writing his memoirs right away, and as he went on writing, he was describing in full details the strange times that Egypt has seen during the attrition war. In that period of time, there were a lot of skirmishes on the front line. There were a lot of commandos raids made by Egyptians, which were on the spot after these Egyptian commandos come back safely with a prisoner or two, or after destroying some of the strong points of the enemy. Egyptian first lines are subjected to brutal bombing, whether these are by planes or by guns or by artillery from the other side, from the enemy side. And therefore, sometimes casualties would occur. Although he's a veterinarian medicine doctor, yet he was given the role or the job to become a first aid supplier, and is always carrying his bag around to support the wounded and do the first aid which he received in it, primary courses, in order to help the soldiers to be transferred to the backline hospitals to receive the proper medical care. He has described in full details how the Egyptian farmers who were nearby to the front wanted to stay behind and not to leave their land. And when some of them, or most of them, were forced to leave, some of them returned again to plant their plants and maintain the field in order to plant and grasp and get back the to the land that they have been planting all their lives. He has described the fears, the hopes, and the bravery of the soldiers. He has described that one of the soldiers, who was supposed to be a ammunition supplier to one of the guns, has disappeared. And a lot of people thought, and his comrades thought for a while, of 1 week, that he was a defector. And unfortunately, or fortunately, should be fortunately, his body was found buried from the skirmish of one of the artillery fires, shells. And so the man was not a deserter. The man was a martyr who died on the spot. He also described the heroism, and he described some cowardice. He described how people behave under fire and how people are strong to maintain their integrity even in these hard times. He has described in full details and has written to us some of the letters that he sent to his parents and letters that were sent back from his family. How these letters usually tend to come back in parcels. So for example, if he write a letter or two to his friends, he would receive few letters coming by all in one parcel, that every month he would receive 20 letters, but they will arrive a bit late. He described the type of passion that they feel and the type of waiting that they feel for these letters. Although the distance between his hometown and this place that he's standing right in front of the Suez Canal might not be more than 200 or 300 kilometers, but it seemed to be very far away. A sense of security and safety that the Egyptians used to have in living in these nearby cities, when they knew, or they can hardly believe, that their fellow countrymen are fighting and dying just 200 kilometers or less away from them. The type of life that Ahmed Hegi has lived through and the amount of emotions that he has written with it these few pages before he died as a martyr in one of the skirmishes on the Suez Canal, right before Suez, before the war, gives us an idea of the type of young people who were living then, the insisting, the persistence, the perseverance, and the knowledge that what they are doing or the sacrifice that they are making for their own country deserves to be made and to be done. I think Ahmed Hegi's book is a book that deserves to be read, in spite of the fact that we are celebrating 50 years after of his death. Yet he is here in the hearts of his family and of his bigger family, the Egypt itself. So, The Memoirs of an Egyptian Soldier in the Suez Canal by Ahmed Hegi, a book that deserves to be read. So, you're still listening to The World of Info, and today is The World of Books. And our final book today was the subject of a real episode with our distinguished and great friend and great friend of Egypt and friend of myself, His Excellency Stéphane Ramaté, the ambassador of France in Egypt. And we talked 2 weeks ago about Napoleon Bonaparte, and today we are presenting in short a book about Napoleon Bonaparte. Why Napoleon? Because we are celebrating, as we mentioned in this special episode, 200 years of the death of Napoleon Bonaparte. And the book is written by an English historian. And therefore, as His Excellency Stéphane Ramaté said, this is not the right way to read the history of Napoleon, because definitely it will not be written fairly. And yes, this was true. And strange enough, I got this book not from a bookshop. And this bookshop, where was it? It was in the Arc de Triomphe de l'Étoile. So this means that the people are selling books that might be condemning to Napoleon in the one of the places that for Napoleon was considered to be an important site in the middle of Paris. Anyway, this is democracy, this is history, and this is part of history. And the book has on its cover a very important sentence written also by a biased writer. And it said, this is a jewel of a book, comprehensive, brief, and passionate. And it's written by The Economist, which is a British magazine. So you will not consider that the British are going to give some admiration to Napoleon Bonaparte after all the wars, the skirmishes, the defeats, the victories that they have encountered with him. And they say that the period of truth that happened between Napoleon and Britain does not exceed maybe less than 1 year. And all through there was animosity, beating up battles, navy battles, success, defeat, but in everywhere Britain was the sole and the most persistent and perseverant enemy of Napoleon. And no wonder that Napoleon Bonaparte, when he was forced to surrender, he was sent to Elba Island, and Elba Island, which is across from Italy, a short distance away from the shore, he was escorted there by a British ship. And when he was finally defeated in Waterloo, well, what happened afterwards is that he was shipped to St. Helena. And St. Helena is an island in the middle of nowhere. Exactly nowhere. And although, as His Excellency Ambassador Stefano Matteo was very precise to say that the whereabouts, the place that Napoleon was buried in, the house of Napoleon Bonaparte on St. Helena, is owned by the French government, by a lease from the British government to St. Helena, in St. Helena, to have this under the French authority, while the rest of the island is completely under control of the British until now. And the truth story is, it's in the middle of nowhere. It doesn't have a big airport, so there are not a lot of tourists or Napoleon fanatics who really visit this island. And the island is in the middle of the ocean. And it was surrounded by the end, until the death of Napoleon, by navy escort ships and navy patrol ships, British Navy patrol ships, in order to prevent Napoleon from having any great ideas of escape. Well, we could hardly see that a man who has lived for a very short period on earth could have such great effect on the history of the world like Napoleon Bonaparte. We know that he was born in 1869 and died in 1769 and died in the year 1821. This gives him almost 52 to 53 years old. Some rumors have it that he was born 1868. Therefore, he will be 50. He would be 53 at the date of his death. And in such a short life, and even forced to retire, or forced to abdict, or forced to be arrested under these circumstances in St. Helena, he lost his power 6 years earlier. So he did everything before the age of 47. And Napoleon Bonaparte, as a young officer and a young controller, and at the same time a brave and a very intelligent officer who was able to navigate his way through politics, proves to be an important person. Also, his role into the civil code is still present up till now, and the establishments that were built by Napoleon Bonaparte and the code of the law code that Napoleon has made, or made under his supervision, proves its importance up till now. Who can doubt whether he was a good man or a bad man? He was on the defeated side, and therefore his enemies are more than his lovers. And history is usually written by the victorious. So when we talk about Napoleon Bonaparte and about his life and time, we have to understand that these are different times than the times of today. We have to understand that without the French Revolution, we could have hardly found a Napoleon Bonaparte. Without the chaos that happened after the French Revolution and the government of the councils, who definitely have betrayed each other and defeated each other, we couldn't have seen Napoleon Bonaparte rising to the power of time at that period. So when we talk about Napoleon Bonaparte, we have to give the idea and the understanding that this gentleman is the product of his age, is the product of his history, and is the product of time. How could he rise up till now, or how could he stand the test of time? How people in France are looking to him today? We have discussed that with His Excellency Ambassador Stéphane Romati. Well, the French are totally different than the they have different opinion, or points of opinion up till now. So what they can say is that we cannot understand why they are looking to Napoleon differently than how they are looking to De Gaulle. It is said completely that Napoleon Bonaparte and De Gaulle are the two important characters that all the French know about in their history. And we have to know that De Gaulle has all the admiration from the French people, even his haters during his lifetime. While Napoleon Bonaparte, people beg to differ. Some people think of Napoleon, the founder of the modern France, the founder of the French pride. And some of them think that Napoleon was causing of a lot of disasters and led to the death of a lot of their grandparents during the different wars that he has fought. So where does Napoleon Bonaparte stand in the hearts of the French? We can hardly answer this question. But definitely he has a place in their hearts. He has a place in their minds, and he has a place in their conscience. How they are looking to him today, or how is the world looking today to Napoleon Bonaparte, remains to be personal variation. For some, like us here in Egypt, would say that Napoleon Bonaparte has brought with him a lot of identification of modern Egypt and waking up Egypt. But for some who are really have a good point of view, Napoleon Bonaparte has brought in with him destruction and defeat to some Egyptians, and of course this was not interesting at all. So the number of massacres that happened, or the number of life or deaths that were spared or killed during Napoleon Bonaparte's time in Egypt, definitely stay under the microscope. So I think by that philosophical analysis to Napoleon Bonaparte, we come back to the end of our show today, The World of Info. Today we presented four books: Napoleon by Paul Johnson, The Memoirs of an Egyptian Soldier on the Suez Canal, The Stories of the Egyptian Mamluks, and The Days of Al-Mahrusa. Stay with us here in Radio Cairo, and hope to see you next week, same time, same station, with World of Info. My name is Dr. Amr Abrook, and Dua Muhammad was at the control.